מסכת מנחות, page 4, we are 9 lines from the top of the page. We learned the Mishnah, כל המנחות שנקמצו שלא לשמם, when you have the meal offering, that kmitza, remember we talk about the three fingers that hold the mincha, so mincha, kmitza was performed for the sake of designation other than our own. So in one hand we said it's valid, ksherot, meaning we accepted it. However, ela shelo alu la ba'alim mishum chova, badanat, credited to the owner as they fulfilled of their obligation, because that's not the one that we have the proper designation. So for example, if the owner has the obligation to bring it for obligatory mincha, and or he brought it for minchat chavitin, remember we talked the beginning, and it turns to be the deep pen, minchat marcheshet. The exception, Mishnah said, is chutz miminchat chote uminchat knaot, except for a sinner mincha offering and a jealousy mincha offering, which is, as we explained, based on the Torah, Parashat Naso, Book of Bamidbar, the husband that suspected his wife to be disloyal. So part of the ritual, the procedure, is to bring minchat knaot, a jealousy offering. So if it was performed, the ritual of kmitza happened to be not with proper intent, shelo lishman, so it's a total invalid, it's total pasul. So now the Gemara zoom in and wants to understand what's the source of these particular two that we said that there are exceptions, that regardless we do not accept the offering, which is again the sinner offering and the jealousy offering, while the Kohen who performed that ritual not have the intent שנקמצו שלא לשמה. So Gemara said, בישלמה מנחת חוטה. If you tell me that here we talk about the sin offering, that when there is a inappropriate, incongruous, unintentional, proper intentional, which call in עברית מנחה, מחשבה, שלא לשמה, חטאת קריי רחמנה. The Torah said it lucidly in the book of Vayikra, chapter 5, verse 11, לא ישים עליה שמן, ולא ייתן עליה לבונה, כי חטאתי. Let's see exactly the translation of the pasuk. The Torah instructed clearly and said, when it's come to the sin offering, the Kohen, he shall not put on oil upon it, neither shall he put any levona, levona we said that is frankincense, upon it, for it is a sin offering. So what you see, the same way as a sin offering is disqualified when sacrificed not for its own sake, the same way you see here that when it's come to meal offering of a sinner, is disqualified when a handful is removed, the kmitza, from the korban, not for its own sake. So, if you remember, in the Perek Rishon, the first chapter of Tractate Zvachim, page 7, we bring the expansion of this idea from the Psukim, and as we said in the introduction, there is a lot of similarity, especially between the first two Perekim of Zvachim, to here, but anyway, so ela minchat knaot menalan. So when you talk about the meal offering of jealousy, again, for those who are not familiar, part of the ritual in order to clarify and bestow shalom bayis, bestow peace between husband and wife, there is a requirement to bring a meal offering of jealousy. It's called minchat knaot. So the Torah did not use the word chatat, meaning a sin. So how do you derive this notion of the Mishnah, the oral teaching that tells what? That machshava shelo lishman, when it was the improper thought of the Kohen, not for the purpose of the original designation, it's nifsal legamrei, is totally disqualified. So Gemara answer, the disalacha derived from a braita. And here we have a braita from erudite, some sage that were very familiar with Mishnayot and Braitot, etc. Obviously, those days was oral by memory. Remember the other day we talked that only when it's really the time of the printing press, much later, things to copy and come out and expand it up to, especially Talmudic time, it was transmitted orally. The Tanakh made the Rav Nachman. So it was Tana that taught this Braita before the very well-known head of Bet Din, a Talmudic sage by name of Rav Nachman. Minchat Knaot Motara Nedava. Money that was designated for a meal offering of jealousy, it's superfluous, which means the money remaining after the purchase of the meal offering is used to purchase communal gift offerings. Let's expand. In the Beit HaMikdash, it was shofarot. As you know, we're getting to Chodesh Elul, the shofar has one side that is small, and then it's large. Unfortunately, nothing changed since the early time, and there are people who are not honest, and they try to steal. So basically, they do it in a way that no one can squeeze his hand and get to that pushkes, to that shofarot, to that contribution of money that people give. So it was a 13 type of shofarot, and six of them have a special designation. So here we are, it's called Nidvat Tzibur. Nidvat Tzibur meaning communal meal offering, communal gift offering. And it was with the purpose to bring it on the altar when is the time that the Mizbeach Batel Mikorbanot, when there is no sacrificial offering of the altar. We're going to study it, God willing, on page 107b. So they take the meat of that burn offering and they give it to God in our language on the altar, but they hide the orot, the skin on that offer, was the same as any ola, that the meat go for the Hashem, for the Mizbeach, for the altar, and the or, and the hide, the skins, was given to the Kohanim, the priest. So here we derive a chidush in this braita, that if money left over, let's say someone gave a $300, right, and $50 left, okay, and that money, the $300 was designated for what? For jealousy offering. How that can be, for example, the price change, you know, everything in the world, the commodity changed the price. So since it changed, you take this barley that the price is different, and you take the money that's left over and you put it inside those shofarot, inside those pushkis, in order to purchase, Rashi explained, olot lenidvat tzibur, the communal offering, kaitza mizbeach, that you give for the public. Rashi's challenge, Rashi, why use kvasim lolot, but anyway, because all the different animals will be fitting for the korbanot tzibur. But anyway, Amar Lei, so Rav Nachman responded to that Tana, and he said, Shapir ke Amar, you are right, mazkeret avon k'tiv ba. If you zoom in Minchat Knaot, again, Book of Bamidbar, Parashat Naso, part of the ritual that Torah said in Bamidbar, chapter 5, verse 15, u'vechatat k'tiv. Again, this is the language of Avon, iniquities. Book of Vayikra, chapter 10, verse 17. Votan, tan lachem, laset et Avon a'eda. That verse speaks about Sir Chatat, the sin offering, that was brought at the 8th day of the Miluim. So since we have this avon, iniquity, and we use the analogy, the verbal analogy, the juxtaposition, so since we have the both, we compare minchat knaot to korban chatat. Ma chatat motara nedava, the same way as the sin offering. What we said, that leftover, if you have surplus, is used to purchase communal gift offering. Af menachot, af minchat knaot motara nedava. So in the second book of Kings, chapter 12, it's a beautiful text that talk about Yehoyada. Yehoyada was the high priest in the Beit HaMikdash, the holy temple at the time of the king Yehoash. So the text, which was one of our haftarot, said, Kesef Hashem, v'chesef chataot lo yuva Beit Hashem, lakohanim yihiyu. So obviously we don't take this pasuk in the literal sense, but it means kesef Hashem v'chesef chataot, which means a surplus money that's left from the contribution for those offering, lo yuva, you don't use it for the temple maintenance, but lakohanim yihiyu, if you have any derivative that can be used for the priest, you can purchase with that a burn offering, as we learned earlier, that their orot, the hide, the skin, used for the kohanim. You see more of that in Mishnah Tractate Shkalim, Mishnah 6. And therefore, we derive also for our discussion, which is improper intent, which means you have psul shelo lishmo, you have disqualification because it was the not the proper intent. So we derive minchat knaot, the jealousy offering, the same as kechatat. Ma chatat psula shelo lishma, the same way as the sin offering is disqualified when sacrificed not for its own sake. The same way, af minchat knaot psula shelo lishma. So the same way is a meal offering of jealousy is disqualified when a handful is removed from it, not for its own sake. So the Gemara challenged this source. They said, Ela me'ata, if you derive by this verbal analogy, by this juxtaposition, also the guilt offering, asham yehe pasul shelo lishmo, a guilt offering should also be disqualified if it was not sacrificed for its own sake. As you have these verbal analogy, this juxtaposition may be derived from the pasuk that states in Leviticus chapter 10, verse 17. Chapter 10, verse 17. That's avon, the iniquity of the congregation. And then you have a sin offering, Leviticus chapter 5, verse 17, that said, and shall bear his iniquity. The Gemara, avon, avon, mechatat. So what we derive from that? You have this verbal analogy, and since it said in both, in Korban Hashem, the guilt offering, and Korban Chatat, the same word that applied to what? To avon, to iniquity. So we derive the same way as a sin offering is disqualified when it's involved with machshava shelo lishma, with the improper thought. The same way as Hashem, a guilt offering, become disqualified when the machshava shelo lishmo. What we learn at the beginning of Tractate Zvachim, that guilt offering is not disqualified when it's the machshevet shelo lishmo. So the Gemara said, danim avon avon, ve'ein danin avono me'avon. You have to go strictly, the Gemara said, with the letters of each word. And since avon, avon is ayin, vav, nun, sofi, the same letter, so we can make this verbal analogy based on that word, which is, in this case, iniquity. Here you have the word avono, which is ayin, vav, nun, vav, which is his iniquity. From the other verse that said what? Avon. Since these words are not equal, So therefore, you cannot use that as verbal analogy. So the Gemara asks, "My nafkamina? What's the real difference between the word avon, ayin vav nun, sofit, versus avono, ayin vav nun vav?" We have this juxtaposition. So vehatana deve Rabbi Ishmael. We learn in one pasuk, Leviticus chapter 14, verse 39, Veshava Kohen. And the other one, the pasuk said, Uvaha Kohen, and the Kohen shall return. And another person said, visit 7 days later, they said, and the Kohen shall come and look. So what do we return? Zohi Shiva, Zohi Bia. This returning and this coming have the same meaning. And what we derive from that, that you have this juxtaposition, you have this verbal analogy, that the halacha that applies if you have the metzora, if the leper, you have the leprosy, has spread at the conclusion of the first week, applies if it has spread again by the end of the following week. So what you see, how much so, that if you have less pronounced difference of one letter between avon and avono, not prevent the teaching of a verbal analogy. And furthermore, ve'od, lo ligmar avono, avono me'avon dishmi'at hakol, dichtiv im lo yagid ve'nasa avono. So we should derive further that if you tell me that you cannot derive avono, ein vav nun vav, from the word avon, so guess what? So we can derive from the avono avon, from the pasuk concerning the sin offering brought for the iniquity of for hearing the voice, which is the sin offering of one who takes a false oath, that he does not have information relevant to a matter that when requests that he testified about it. And the Torah said, Im lo yagid, in Leviticus chapter 5, if he is not uttered, venasa avono, it shall carry the sin. So just a little more, we have learned about the shvuat ha'edut, you take an oath of a variable, korban olev yored, remember, someone who's rich, accordingly, someone is poor, have a very basic. So Reuven is suing Shimon, and he requested, because it's over monetary issue, and Shimon said that doesn't have anything to do with anything, and he take a false oath. So the one who did it needs to bring, according to his capability, a sin offering. So that's called Shmi'at HaKol, which means he heard the voice of the other party who asked him to take an oath over that issue, over that money. So if it was Machshava Shelo Lishmo, if it was the intent was not for that sake, so the same as any other sin offering, the Gemara in Zvachim, verse 8, page 8 said, the same as other Korban Zvachim, that Korban Zchatat, sin, iniquity, offering, has become invalid. Over there, if you see Tosfot, page 8b in Zvachim, the Bura Matchil Ligmar expand on that. So now the Gemara accept that claim and derive in a conclusion that because of that, you cannot derive this psul, this qualification of shelo lishmo, from this verbal analogy, from this juxtaposition, or from chatat, from a sin offering. Ela, so therefore, by force of circumstance, we must say, ki gamrei gzera shava, when the sages come out with the verbal analogy, it was derived only with regard to halacha, that the surplus, Lemotar nedava hu degamrei, the surplus from the money designated for a meal offering of jealousy, is used to purchase the communal gift offering, And not with regard to halacha that the meal offering of jealousy from a handful was removed, not for its own sake, is disqualified. That's one of the masorot, the idea of Gzera Shavad, one of the 13 principles of Rabbi Ishmael. So that's the Mefarshim said, you derive this Gzera Shavad of Avon Avon, you derive only the money left over from jealousy, from Minchat Sotah, and the guilt offering, that the money left over, the surplus, should go to Nidvat Tzibur, the same as sin offering, but you cannot derive it that from that word, from that verbal analogy, that if it was machshava shlo lishma, if it was improper thought, that offering is disqualified. You cannot do it. So anyway, v'chi teima, and if you will say that there is a principle, there ein gzera shava lemechza, we learn it several times in the Shas, that there is no partial verbal analogy, that principle does not apply in this instant. So the Gemara continued and said, excuse me, וכי תימה אין גזרה שווה למחצה, גלי רחמנה אגבי חטאת, ושחט אותה לחטאת. The Torah said in Leviticus chapter 4, and slaughter it for a sin offering. So what we derive from that? For the Gemara in Zvachim, page 7, said that that's applied to what? To chatat yachid, to individual sin offering. So lechatat, meaning you have to have the proper intent, which is leshem chatat, for the purpose of sin offering. So here, the Gemara derived from the word otah, that's basically to put an exclusion, that solely applies to sin offering. You see more in Gemara in Zvachim, page 5. But anyway, v'shachat ota lefanav, ota lishma ksheira, the sin offering, when slaughtered for its own sake, it's valid. However, shelo lishma, not for its own sake, for meaning for the sake of sin offering, is disqualified. However, aval kol kodashim, but when it's come to all the other type of sacrificial animals, ben lishman uven shelo lishman ksherim, whatever the sacrificial offering is, for its own sake or not for its own sake, it's valid. So here you derive the whole idea of using the word otah. We basically cannot derive this verbal analogy from chatat. So ela minchat chote, you remember we quote the Mishnah that said that there are two types of offering, meal offering, that if it wasn't for the proper sake, makes it invalid, which is what? Sin offering and jealousy offering. So when the handful is removed, not for its own sake, makes it disqualified. How you derive it? Menalan. So the Gemara brings another soul for this disqualification of minchat chote, sin offering, and minchat knao, the jealousy, that when it was handful, not for its own sake. Chatat ta'ama mai mishum dechtiv ba hi, hach ktiv behu hi. When it's come to a sin offering, the reason is that it's disqualified. When sacrifice not for its own sake, it's because it's rightly written. When it's come to this offering, it. You see it in Leviticus chapter 4, verse 24. So chatat he, who, it's the shchat oto b'mchom asher shchat oto lefnei Hashem chatat hu. So Tosfot comment that if you go over the tractate Zvachim, page 7b, it's a different pasuk. But anyway, haname aktiv b'uhu. Why? Because that's what is written in the sin offering minchat chote. It's come to jealousy offering, they said minchat knaot hu. So therefore we derive from that if it was incongruous, inappropriate intent, when it's machshava shelo lishmam, that makes it disqualified. So the moral challenge, if that's the case, how about guilt offering? Asham name aktiv behu. Do I use the same word as it? Aktiv behu, Leviticus 7, verse 5. So it should derive the same way as we did the sin offering to guilt offering. Make it disqualified. So they said, no. Ha-hu, hu lachar k'tarat imurinu dechtiv. Here, the intent was different. The Torah used that after the burning of the sacrificial portion of the guilt offering, which are intended for burning upon the altar. Ki detanya. אבל השם לא נאמר בו הוא אלא לאחר הכתרת הימורים הוא עצמו שלא יכתרו הימוריו כאשר, for example, if they lost or they become ritually impure. So you cannot say that this pasuk teaches that when you have a guilt offering that become disqualified when it's מחשבת שלו לשמו, so it's accepted. ואלא הוא למה לי? So why do I need the word it when it's come to guilt offering? So Gemara said, "Nitak lich de Ravuna, Amar Rav, Asham shenitak l'riya ushchato stam kasher l'shum ola." That's derived from Ravuna, who said that when it's come to a guilt offering, whose owner died, or whose transgression was otherwise atoned for, and that was therefore consigned by the court to gazing, right? Until it develops a blemish. We said it many times that in those cases that it can be sold and proceed used to purchase a burnt offering. If before it develop a blemish, someone slaughtered l'riya ushchato stam, Rav Asham shenitak l'riya ushchato stam kasher l'shum ola. If someone came out and he used it, slaughtered without specification of its own purpose, its feet, if it was sacrificed as a burnt offering. So the Gemara derived from that and said, wait a second. Nitak in, if it was consigned to grazing, yes, it is fit for that was sacrificed as a burnt offering, if slaughtered. But lo nitak, if it was not consigned to grazing, lo, it's not. What's the reason for that? Amar krahu bahavayato yehe. Torah said, use the word he, which means as a guilt offering, unless it is consigned by the court to another purpose. So what we learn in the Mishnah, that all these menochot that was the kmitza happened to be not for its own sake, so it's okay, it's befitting, but lo alula ba'alim l'shem chova, is not befitting for the owner, it's obligatory offering. The exception again is minchat chote, sin offering, and minchat knaot. Those two exceptions, if it wasn't for the proper intent, so you can't do anything, it's total disqualified. Amar Rav, minchat ha'omer shekmatza shelo lishma psula. Rav said, you have the omer, meal offering. The Torah tells us in Leviticus chapter 23, the measure of barley brought as a communal offering on the 16th of Nisan. So they said, if the Kohen somehow happened to remove the handful, not for its own sake, so it's disqualified. It's disqualified since an Omer meal offering came for a specific purpose. Ho'ilu bata lehatir velo hitira, which is the whole purpose of what is to permit the consumption of the new crop, tvuah chadasha. And this meal offering did not permit the consumption of the new crop because its rites were performed not for its own sake. V'chen ata omer, the same you said about what? Ba'asham nazir, when it's come to a guilt offering of a nazir, right, to become ritually impure, whose proper sacrifice enables the nazir to restart his nazirut afresh in purity. page 4b ואשם מצורה ששחתן שלא לשמן כפולים ולובהו להכשיר ולא הכשירו. Before we go further, it's important point we need to understand. There are two different concepts we need to know when it's come to here with the guilt offering. Here we talk about Nazirite guilt offering and leper guilt offering. There is a concept in Halakha that is called Lehachshir, and is another concept that is called Lechaper. What's the real difference? When it's come to Lehachshir, meaning if you have a case such as a person who is Nazir, who is Nazirite, and we learn already that Nazirite is 30 days, all of a sudden it turns that he touched a dead body. He needs to go from square one, but he needs to bring a special offering that is called Asham. That Asham, that guilt offering, Machshiro, make him in a way, in our simple language, Kasher, but it's basically restructured again, or almost like you push the delete button and you start from scratch. So in that sense, it's paved the way for him to go to a process which is eventually paving to be a person who's free from all those obligations of Nazir. So the Torah said in the Bamidbar chapter 6, ve'vi kesef keves ben shnato le'asham ve'ayimim rishonim yiplu. The same when it's come to leper, the Torah said in Vayikra 14 that again machshirato, he needs to bring a guilt offering in order to be pure, to purify himself. Now, when it's come to kapara, soon you see we are more lenient. In a sense, soon you see how is the view that when it's have the atonement, so something happened, you still accepted the offering, but he needs to bring another one. Versus when it's come to lehachshir, then it's different story. So here it says, Hashem Nazir v'Hashem Metzorah. You have a guilt offering of Nazir, and you have the guilt offering of leper, whose proper sacrifice enables the leper to enter the Israelite camps and to partake offering of sanctity. Sheshchatan shelo lishmam, that was slaughtered not for its own sake. So they said psulim. Why? Uhuil ubau lehachshir. Remember this word. It makes the leper fit. It makes the Nazir fit. So that's different than the concept of kapara. Kapara is to atone. Lehachshir, to change the status to be fitting. So therefore, and this guilt offering did not render him fit. So the Gemara now challenged the first point of Rav Tanan. That we learn at the early part in the Mishnah. Kol ha-menachot she-nikmetzu shelo lishnan kshirot, elo shelo la-belim shem chuvah chus melechat choter melechat knaot. That was the title at the very beginning. All the menachot, when they did the kmitza, by force of circumstance, if it wasn't for their own sake, it's fitting. The exception, what we said, the two, which is chote and knaot. But the owner, we said that if it's a kol ha-menachot, so it's can ascend to the mizbeach, but he needs to bring another one. Lo alu lebalim l'shem chovah, the owner did not fulfill his obligatory. Versus the two, the chotem knaot, that even the mizbeach is total psulim, they cannot take them. The im ita, if you tell me that minchat omer become disqualified when it was improper intent, or machshava shelo lishma, litnei namei, the mishnah should add chutz miminchat haomer, except for the offer, for the omer meal offering. So the Gemara brings now several explanations. What's the reason the Mishnah did not mention minchat haomer among the list of menachot that become disqualified when it's machshevet shelo lishman? Ki katane ba'a yachid, ba'a tzibur lo katane. So the Mishnah teach, when it's come to that offering on behalf of individual, the Mishnah does not teach the halacha when it's come to those meal offerings that come on behalf of the community. Furthermore, ki tane ba'a biglal atzma, which means without any other offering. Ba'a biglal zevach, which is combining with zevach, which is the Omer meal offering together with the slaughter offering, which is brought along with two sheep, lo katane. The Minchat Omer needs to be offered in a very specific time, which is, Rashi reminds us, it was the 16th day of month of Nisan, versus all the rest of the Menachot can be offered any time during the year. Now the Gemara transfer the discussion to the second part. Of the Rav, Amar Mar v'chen ata omer ba'asham nazir ba'asham metzora shesh chatan shalo lishmam psulim hu'il u'ba'u le'achshir ve'lo ichshiru. Now I'm just going to read and then we go to the basic difference, as we said earlier, between le'achshir and kapara. Le'achshir, it changed and transformed the status. We take it much severely. Kapara, to atone. So as we said, kapara can be a case that it ascend and not descends, but the owner needs to bring a new one. Le'achshir, it's much severe. Let's see it. Amar mar, v'chen ata omer ba'asham nazir ba'asham metzora shesh chatan shalo lishmam פסולים, ההואיל ובאו להכשיר ולא הכשירו. תנן. כל הזבחים ששחטן שלו לשמם כשרים, אלא שלא להגביל משם חובה. That's what we said earlier from זבחים חוץ מפסח וחטן. Exception is Paschal offering and sin offering. ואם איתה, if you tell me that these two guilt offering become disqualified when the מחשבה שלו לשמה, the thought was not proper, ליתני נמד, המשנה שהוא עושה, חוץ מהשם נזיר והשם מצורע, דבאו להכשיר ולא הכשירו. So the Gemara responded and said, כיוון דאיקה, השם גזלות והשם מעילות, the lechapara atu, because we have these two, the guilt offering of robbery, which one brings for taking a false oath, denying an accusation of robbery, and guilt offering brought for misuse of consecrated property, that basically the concept is, as we said earlier, lechapara, lechapara, meaning to atone, so even it was nishchat shelo lishmo, even it was slaughtered, not for its purpose, but since the goal is for the atonement, so it's lopsikale. The Tana cannot say it definitely, because here we talk about different status, which is atonement. The atonement does not rend one feet and our feet for sacrifice if they were slaughtered, not for their sake. So the Tana cannot speak in absolute matter, and therefore he refrains from mentioning guilt offering at all. Ma'ishna Hashem Nazir v'Hashem Metzora de'ba'u l'achshir v'lo ichshiru, hanenau ba'u l'chapara v'lo kipru. What's the difference when we come to a guilt offering of Nazir and guilt offering of a leper, because they came to render feet and they did not render feet, which is the guilt offering for a robbery and for misuse of consecrated property should, in a way, the same be disqualified when slaughtering not for the sake, since the same atonement and they did not atone. Amar Rabbi Yirmiya, and that's the point I tried to tell you earlier, the point of view of so sophisticated and beautiful and word cannot express the deep thought of Rabbi Yirmiya. Amar Rabbi Yirmiya, matzinu shechilek hakatuv ben mechaprim uvein machshirim. Which is, we have two avenues of offering. We have one that atone for the one who brought for their sins. There are those who come to make those people fit, leachshir, which means the owner prohibited to something and that basically switch their status. So sin offering and guilt offering usually they come to atone for a very specific sin. There are situations that they come to change the status. For example, remember we just said what you have, Asham Nazir, the guilt offering of Nazir, and Asham Metzora, the guilt offering of a leper. Why? Because Nazir, he can start again his Nazirut if he touches the body. With Metzora, he can enter to Machane Israel. So Rabbi Yirmiya explained to us that we have huge differentiation between these two concepts, between Korbanot Sheba'im Lechaper, the offering that come to atone, Korbanot Sheba'im Lechashir. So here he explained, it beudat mechaprim it beudat ulachar mita machshirim let beudat ulachar mita. That's so proper before Shoshana and Yom Kippur. We have the Chilukei Kapara, and we talk many times in different classes, the Rambam and the whole preparation for Days of Or. So part of the idea of being atoned, we should understand, it happens that the owner, while in the process, is no longer among the living. So there are circumstances that the owner, the moment the owner passed away, so it's no longer obligation to bring the offering because he's gone. Versus, so that's applied to what? To mechaprim, right? So korbanot mechaprim it be'ut be'atu lachar mita, which means korbanot that come, offering that come, that atone, they are among these them offering that come after that, which is their sacrifice after the death of the owner. Versus machshirim, the korbanot that render the person feed, there are none among them that come after the. That's so beautiful. Okay? So mechaprim is only the atonement l'shum chova. Machshirim, if the krivan shelo lishmam, if he offer them not for the purpose, nifselu legamrei, they are totally disqualified. Dit nan. Rabbi Yirmiyahu prove his point from a famous Mishnah, Tractate Kinim, chapter 2, Mishnah 5. Ha'isha, you have Isha Yoledet, you have woman, Mazel Tov, she have the baby. So now she brings a, follow the biblical precept, she brings a sin offering and burn offering after the delivery, right? She'evia chatata, so this poor mother, she brought the offering of sin offering, and unfortunately, before she was able to bring the burn offering, umeta, she no longer among the living. So here you have the descendants, the tzeitzaim, the others, the family members, what the obligation? Yaviu yorshin et olata. So those heir, those people who inherit her, they have the obligation to bring her burn offering. Now, the Torah tells us in the book of Vayikra, chapter 12, that it depends on the status. Usually a woman that delivers a child, she needs to bring keves le'ola, right, for burn offering, uben yona otor lechatat, for a sin offering. But if she's so poor, so she bring two toim and two bnei yona, one for burn and one for sin offering. So if, this is the chidush in the Mishnah, that if the yoledet brought the chatat, the sin offering, and then she passed away before she was able to bring the burn offering, the Osheha, the heir, had the obligation to bring the offering. It's a big discussion of Maran Kiddushin 13, if she set aside while she was alive or not, but anyway. So, however, Olata Umeta, but if it's the other way around, if the Oledet brought her burn offering and then she passed away, Lo yaviu yorshin lechatata, the heir should not bring a sin offering as it comes to render her feet to partake of offering. So it means the chata, the sin offering, is the machshir, and the burn offering is the atonement, the mechaper. So what do you see here? So the machshir is not befitting after the passing, and mechaper, the atonement, it is. So matkif la Rabbi Yehuda b'Rei d'Rabbi Shimon ben Pazi, machshirin namei milei behu de'atu lachar mita ve'atnan. That's a famous Gemara in Tractate Me'ila, page 11. The Gemara said, "Mafrish ma'ot lin ziruto." You have here a situation of nezirah that he set aside money in order to bring an offering when he's done with his nezirut. And he did not specify to which offering is all he had to bring. That's the Torah in the book of Bamidbar, chapter 6, right? The Gemara said that he needs to bring three different offerings. You need to bring keves as a burn offering, you need to bring kivsa as a sin offering, and then you need to bring ram ayil lishlamim as a peace offering. So together he brings two breads. The Torah said in Bamidbar, chapter 6, Solet chalot brulot b'shemen, u'kikei mitzot meshuchin b'shamen. So he shaved his hair, the Nazir, and then he allowed to do a regular thing like drinking wine, you know, help with touching the body of the dead, etc., etc. So it means that offering machshirim make the nazir fit to allow to go ahead and do what he was prohibited. Lo nehenim velo moalim mipnei shiraui shiruin lavo kulam shlemim. So he said here that the coins are fit for bringing peace offering, and there are no misuse of consecrated property with regard to funds fit for a peace offering. Then they said, met if the Nazir passed away before he brought his offering, v'hayu lo ma'ot stumim, and he had undesignated funds that he set aside to pay his Nazirut offering without specifying how much money should be allocated toward each offering. Yiplulin dava. So basically they go for a communal guilt offering. Dmei chatat, money for the sin offering. So you have no choice, you lich le'amamelach. I'd get rid, throw it in the Dead Sea. Some said Yamagadol, Rambam Hilchot Tzitzit, chapter 2. Anyway, it's a discussion, what does that mean? If it's specifically like Rashi, Yam HaMelech, or not. Anyway, Rabbeinu Chanan in Pesachim 28, many more discuss what does that mean. Lo nehenim velo moalim. Dmei olah yavi bahem olah moalim bahem. Dmei shlamim yavi bahem shlamim venechalim liyom echad ventunim lechem. So the Gemara asked, והעולה הוא שלמים דנזרים דמכשירים נינו, וכעתו לאחר מיתה. סגמר יסד, אומר רב פאפה, הרחק אמר רבי ירמיה, לא מצינו הכשר קבוע דבה לאחר מיתה, ודנזיר הכשר שאינו קבוע הוא. פייג' 5, דאמר מר, גילח על אחת משלושתם, meaning, he shaved after he did one of these three obligatory, which is after sacrificing his sin offering, burn offering, or sin or peace offering, he has fulfilled his obligation b'diavad, after the fact. He had successfully completed the term of Nezirut, and accordingly is no specific offering that renders him fit. So the Gemara challenged from a bright amati ve'asham et surah shesh nishchat shelo lishmo, or shelo nitan midamo al gabei behonot. That's the behonot of the leper, of the metzora. The right thumb and big toe. So this guilt offering is offered upon the altar and it requires libations. So the Gemara said, Tuvta de Rav, it's a serious refutation on the Rav, because Rav said that guilt offering of a leper that was slaughtered not for its own sake is entirely disqualified because it's not rendered the leper fit.